Sisters and brothers, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I am honored to reflect with you today on God's word we've heard this afternoon, and especially in light of the investiture of Dr. Reynold Verret as the sixth president of Xavier University. I'm also honored to call Dr. Verret a friend. So I also will reflect with you today on the Dr. Verret that I know in light of the Word of God. It's all good, that's all. I'm also very happy to return to New Orleans and particularly to Xavier University. My first visit to the city was in 1978. It was on that occasion, actually, that I first met Bishop Guillory. At the time, he was simply Father Guillory. He was pastor of St. Augustine's Church. But I came in that year of 1978 during the Mardi Gras weekend. And I came during a weekend where the Xavier Gold Rush were actually playing Dillard University. And they were playing the game in the barn. Well, the place was packed. It was packed. And the folks were real loud. I don't know that I've ever heard a game so loud. And the cheers were off the hook. They really were off the hook. And Xavier, of course, won that game. In 40 years, I can honestly say, in 40 years, I have never since attended a more exciting game of basketball at any college that I've ever visited or taught at or attended. So the pleasure today is really mine. The pleasure is mine to be in this pulpit, to be at this university, and with this new president, giving praise to the God of Jesus Christ and reflecting on his holy word. During my own college years, I would attend a second Sunday evening service at a Baptist church in the Roxbury section of Boston. The monthly service would draw predominantly college-age black students in the Boston area. The theme song for the second Sunday service every month was the song titled "Lift Him Up." Lift him up. The refrain was, "Lift him up, lift him up. Still he speaks from eternity. If I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me." I would come away from those second Sunday evening services at 12th Baptist Church in Roxbury uplifted and rejoicing. I would also come away challenged every single time. The recurring monthly questions were, what can I? Or how can I? Or where should I? Or which must I? The challenge, of course, began to articulate itself over time as purely a call from the Lord. I would return to my laboratory, my problem sets, my classes, unsure of the answers, struggling to resolve my studies, my expectations, my hopes, with an unrelenting and unambiguous call from the Lord. Well, that was over 40 years ago. And still, the Lord speaks from eternity. In the age of Abraham, the Lord speaks. There's an outstanding painting by William Pageau, a 1946 graduate of Xavier University. And the painting depicts Abraham with his head inclined upwards and his hand clutching the knife that would have killed his son Isaac. And Isaac is suspended in the air just below the level of Abraham's vision. And Abraham's face, it's contorted in pain. It's contorted as he struggles with a challenge that would become his call. In the age of Moses, the Lord speaks. In the age of King David, he speaks. In the age of Jesus Christ, he speaks as he has never spoken before. Throughout eternity, the Lord has called certain persons who would, as the church folks say, stand in the gap. Stand in the gap. In the age of the prophet Ezekiel, the Lord condemned that land, calling it unclean and accusing the powerful of practicing oppression by wronging the poor and needy, oppressing the resident alien without justice. The Lord searched the land for somebody who would stand in the gap before the Lord. The Lord searched for someone who would protect the faithful and who would stay his hand from destroying the land. It is the matriarch who stands in the gap. It's the prophet who stands in the gap. It's the president who stands in the gap. It's the Savior who stands in the gap. 100 years ago in New Orleans, when prejudice and bigotry in the church sanctuaries here threatened the very existence of Catholic life in this city, a saint and a visionary would stand together in agreement. They would together stand in the gap, begging the Lord's indulgence on Catholic New Orleans. Catherine Drexel, founder of the Sisters of the Blessed Sacrament, Josephite, Father Pierre Lebeau, they would stand in agreement on the need to establish a means for black men and women to worship and minister among themselves without fear, holy and righteous in God's eyes. Archbishop Blank of New Orleans saw the establishment of Xavier University in 1915 and the many parishes and schools for people of color in this city as God's hands at work, relieving the hemorrhaging of black Catholics that was going on in the Catholic Church in New Orleans. He welcomed the ministry of Mother Catherine with her army, virtual army of women religious, and the generosity of her financial support in establishing black houses of worship and black parishes and a black normal school for teachers and a black college. That colony church, that colony of black churches and schools and colleges in this Crescent City. It preserved the long-standing devotion to the Catholic Church, which was found both among freed slaves and free persons of color in New Orleans. Jim Crow segregation in the early 20th century, it touched even our Catholic Church, and it did its best. It did its best to dull the taste of Catholic life among the oppressed, those oppressed by segregation in Louisiana. Yet the word of the Lord, it rang true for Catherine Drexel and Pierre Lebeau, who saw these men and women they were serving as the salt of the earth. The salt of the earth for this city. The departure of blacks from the faith of their ancestors would have destroyed the very heart and soul of the Catholic Church here in New Orleans. What good would the Catholic Church have ever been to the Word of God and to salvation history if it had lost its taste among the oppressed of this city? Speaking from eternity, the Lord would answer that the church here would no longer be good for anything but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. Instead, Xavier University and its many parishes and schools that emerged from that troubled era in American Catholic history have been a light to this city and to this state and even to our country. The Sisters of the Blessed Sacrament, in collaboration with the Josephites and other religious orders of men and women, especially the Sisters of the Holy Family, they illuminated the Catholic world with the many possibilities for fruitful ministry among black people. Xavier University in the 1920s and 1930s changed the entire landscape of New Orleans. It offered religious and economic opportunity among black people here. Xavier and the new churches that were formed in the early 20th century would achieve the master art of humanity, in the words of Catherine Drexel, by leading men and women to God. All because somebody allowed themselves to be used by God. Somebody had the courage to answer a call. Somebody would stand in the gap to stay the hand of God. I was fortunate as a young pastor that my first church took its faith and its culture from the experience of black Catholics in New Orleans, even to the extent that my congregation in Los Angeles referred to itself as Little Corpus Christi. Are you ready? Although largely populated by families who escaped the ravages of racism in the Gulf region, the love of my people for New Orleans and Texas was always palpable in our church in Los Angeles. There has always been an esprit among Louisiana people, especially people from New Orleans. In my former church, any social gathering of parishioners became an excuse for a second love. Mardi Gras equaled Christmas and Easter and Mother's Day in the faithful attention of our people. We sang when the saints come marching in more often than Precious Lord at the funeral. A visit to the church by any Creole priest from New Orleans would become an occasion for the good Catholic women of my church to go to war over their gumbo recipe. And the Zydeco I would learn was not a river in Egypt. Instead, it was cowboy boots and Stetson hats. Truth and falsity in my little Corpus Christi in Los Angeles were always rooted in some commonly held family experience of the 7th Ward of New Orleans. You know, what did your grandma do to my uncle? You know, what did your daddy do to my cousin? Ooh, shit. But it was always, church, it was always the annual visit of Dr. Norman Francis to Los Angeles, which would stop the clocks. It would suspend the buses. It would close the stores. The love for Xavier University was beyond anyone's ability in Los Angeles to explain rationally. Somehow Xavier was able to reconcile the competing but necessary experiences for Black Catholics who originated in the Gulf. They both hated the segregation and loved the culture which emerged from it. In some way, faith in the God of Jesus Christ and identity with these wonderful institutions here like Xavier represented the only way to keep people from lapsing into simple bitterness or escapism. The sons and daughters of New Orleans around this country would remember well the response of Xavier University to the crisis that was occasioned by Hurricane Katrina. The threat of the absolute loss of valued lives here and in the city, and the beloved properties that would have gone lost, evoked an outpouring of generosity from New Orleans people around the world and country. When the city and the state and even the federal government were overwhelmed by the storm's scale and intensity, when the threat of total destruction was never greater, Dr. Francis and a capable team of Xavier administrators stood in the gap. Like Mother Catherine, like Father Lebeau before him, Dr. Francis would find supplies, transportation, resources to protect a future for Black people right here. This was like a second founding, if you will, for Xavier University, a kind of pruning, a strengthening, a replanting of the vine first nourished by the Sisters of the Blessed Sacrament, the aftermath of the storm strengthened the resolve of this academic community to be salt for this city, to be a beacon of light for Black and Catholic people everywhere, to lead men and women to God. For those of us who hold to our faith, those of us who care about our cultural traditions, or who want to fulfill our Catholic responsibility of ministering to the needs of others, for us, life will never be easy. It will never be easy. There's always a level of vulnerability which we wear simply because we refuse to hide our color, to hide our belief in God under a bushel basket. We refuse. We refuse to stand at the bottom of the hill rather than at the top where others may see how simply cool it is to be black, to be Catholic, and to be very smart. Nevertheless, the forces of interdiction are never too distant. The Visigoths, as they say, are always at the gates. The darkness always threatens the light, even if it can't overcome it. So the outstanding performance of Xavier graduates in attaining coveted admissions to medical schools and graduate programs may first be met with curiosity that black students would so easily outpace their competition. The curiosity, of course, becomes surprised when a Catholic University of Black Scientists repeats yearly such a remarkable performance, and the curiosity becomes a concern when the notion of a Southern, historically black and Catholic university annually rips the fabric of American self-understanding of what is normal and what is good, and what is right. You see, it was in conditions just like this that St. Paul, he pondered his role of priesthood for the ever-growing and accomplished Gentile Christian community in the Roman world. The Gentile community would threaten the national self-understanding in their unabashed conviction and witness to Jesus Christ. At the same time, the Gentiles would present an entirely new and challenging appropriation of Judaism and the covenant. St. Paul would say to the Romans that his role was to present them as acceptable and sanctified offering to God, while at the same time, St. Paul was leading them to obedience through word and deed. St. Paul would be the priest, building a wall of security around his Gentile community, standing in the gap for them so that God wouldn't destroy the land. God would stay his hand from destroying the landed evil which surrounds and threatens his people. With the premonition of a true visionary, Dr. Reynold, Verret, he once referred to black youth who are immersed in the study of science, he called them a priesthood. It would be that Reynold Verret, it could be that Reynold Verret was remembering a t-shirt we used to wear when we were graduate students at MIT in Cambridge, Massachusetts. The t-shirt was actually a riff on the creation story in the book of Genesis. On the t-shirt, you see, it was written, "And God said," and then there was this listing of the historic Maxwell's equations in all their mathematical elegance, four equations. And at the end of the t-shirt, it would say, "And there was light." The t-shirt suggested that God uttered these mathematical statements and there was light. If the scientist is called to reveal or explain God's world to the ignorant, to the skeptics, then indeed the scientist is a priest. If the scientist must struggle to fulfill some of the greatest needs of humankind under the constraints of the world that God has made, then indeed the scientist is a priest. the time of that interview, Dr. Verret was a young chairman of the new Department of Biochemistry at Clark Atlanta University, and he was being interviewed about his experience of studying at MIT. He was interviewed in the early 90s by the late Dr. Clarence Williams. He was one of our great mentors and an advocate for all black students and engineers at MIT. When Reynold was asked how he came to know and love science, he reminisced about his teachers at the Catholic high school he attended, who, though the classes included large numbers of kids from Brooklyn's inner city, those teachers maintained the highest expectations of their students.